Hello everyone, I am Dr. Tanushree and welcome to the video on Vaccine Development in CSIR Net Life Science, Principal Challenges and Innovations.
So let's begin with what is a vaccine and how it is developed. Vaccine is a biological preparation that provides active acquired immunity to a particular infectious disease. It's a biological product that can be used to safely induce an immune response that confers protection against infection or disease on subsequent exposure to a pathogen. So, vaccine development has been a very successful strategy in the prevention of highly contagious or serious disease like smallpox, which is no longer a threat to human health. So, what is in a vaccine? A vaccine typically contains an agent that resembles a disease-causing microorganism and is often made from weakened or killed forms of the microbe, its toxins, or one of its surface proteins. So basically, these agents are the antigens or the polysaccharides. Vaccines contain antigens that are either derived from pathogen or produced synthetically to represent components of the pathogen. The essential component of most vaccines is one or more protein antigens that induce immune responses that provide protection. However, polysaccharides, antigens can also induce protective immune responses and are the basis of vaccines that have been developed to prevent several bacterial infections like pneumonia, meningitis caused by Streptococcus pneumonia. Even the vaccines, they contain a pathogen in attenuated or weakened or inactive state that may be given to human beings or animals to confer immunity to infection. So vaccines are now most commonly being generated by using gene cloning and recombinant DNA technology. The use of gene cloning in the field of vaccine development centers on the discovery that virus-specific antibodies are sometimes synthesized in response not only to whole virus particle but also to isolated components of the virus. So this is particularly true of purified preparation of proteins present in the viral coat. So virus coat proteins can be isolated and they can be injected into the bloodstream, which induces an immune response. So antibodies are synthesized specific to the coat protein by the human body. So when later infected by a complete virus, the individual can generate an immune response. So antibodies generated can bind to the complete virus and can inactivate it. And as I told you that gene cloning and recombinant DNA technology has been used in development of the vaccines. So using these techniques, the genes which are coding for antigenic proteins of a particular virus could be identified and inserted into an expression vector. So this expression vector containing the genes coding for antigenic proteins of a particular virus can then be used for production of recombinant proteins that might be used as vaccines. So these vaccines, they have the advantage that they would be free of intact virus particles and they could be obtained in large quantities. So a number of vaccines have been synthesized biologically through recombinant DNA technology, and these vaccines are effective against numerous serious diseases caused by bacteria, virus, or protozoa. And these include vaccines for polio, malaria, cholera, hepatitis, rabies, and smallpox and more. So usually the protection which has been conferred by vaccine is measured in clinical trials that relate immune response to the vaccine antigen to clinical endpoints such as prevention of infection, reduction in disease severity, or a decreased rate of hospitalization. Now let's know about different types of vaccines. Vaccines are generally classified as live or non-live, sometimes loosely referred to as inactivated, to distinguish those vaccines that contain attenuated replicating strains of the relevant pathogenic organism from those that contain only component of a pathogen or killed whole organism. So here on your screen is a table that summarizes the different types of vaccines. Live vaccines are developed so that in an immunocompetent host, they replicate sufficiently to produce a strong immune response, but not so much as to cause significant disease manifestations. For example, vaccines for measles, mumps, rubella, yellow fever, rotavirus, oral polio vaccine, BCG vaccine for tuberculosis, and live attenuated influenza vaccine and more. The antigenic component of non-live vaccines, example, whole cell produces vaccine and inactivated polio vaccine, purified proteins from the organism, for example, a cellular produces vaccine, recombinant proteins, for example, hepatitis B virus vaccine, or polysaccharides, for example, pneumococcal vaccine against pneumonia. So in addition to traditional live and non-live vaccines, several other platforms have been developed over the past few decades, including viral vectors, nucleic acid-based RNA and DNA vaccines, virus-like particles, and more. So let's know about some more different types of vaccines. So toxoid vaccine, for example, tetanus and diphtheria are formaldehyde inactivated protein toxins that have been purified from the pathogen. Then we even have the subunit vaccine. So as I told you, purified protein or recombinant proteins can be used. So subunit vaccine is a vaccine that contains purified parts of the pathogen that are antigenic or are necessary to elicit a protective immune response. Then virus-like particle is a type of vaccine that mimics how naturally occurring viruses appears to our body. So virus-like particles assemble to mimic the structure of real virus but are not infectious and therefore do not cause disease. Outer membrane vesicles are natural occurring bacterial delivery system that can transfer cargo such as nucleic acid proteins and lipids to proximal cells or biofilms. Then in a conjugated vaccine, the weak antigen is covalently attached to a strong antigen, thereby eliciting a strong immunological response to the weak antigen. Most commonly, the weak antigen is a polysaccharide that is attached to strong protein antigen. Then a viral vector vaccine is a vaccine that uses a viral vector to deliver genetic material, that is DNA, that can be transcribed by the recipient host cell as messenger RNA coding for a desired protein or antigen to elicit an immune response. The nucleic acid vaccines use genetic material from a disease-causing virus or bacterium, that is a pathogen, to stimulate an immune response against it. Then use of live bacteria as a vector to deliver heterologous antigens is an effective and original alternative to a development of new vaccines. An antigen-presenting cell vaccine is a vaccine made of antigens and antigen-presenting cells. So how vaccines are developed? There are different phases of vaccine development, as you can see it on your screen. The very first phase is exploratory. This is a research intensive phase of the vaccine development process. It is designed to identify natural or synthetic antigens that might help prevent or treat a disease. These antigens might include weakened strains of a particular virus. Then second stage is preclinical. During this phase, researchers, usually in private industry, they use tissue culture, cell culture systems and animal testing to determine whether the candidate vaccine will produce immunity. So many candidate vaccines don't move on to the next stage of the development because they fail to produce that immunity or prove harmful to test subjects. Then clinical development. The vaccine must pass three trial stages of human testing. So here I have included separately the preclinical and the clinical developmental stage. So as I told you, in preclinical stage during this phase, the tissue culture, cell culture system, animal testing is being done to determine whether candidate vaccine will produce immunity. And only those which are successful is passed on to the clinical development, which has three stages of human testing. So phase one is where, so phase one, it administers the candidate vaccine to a small group, that is fewer than 100 people, with the goal of determining whether the candidate vaccine is safe and to learn more about the responses it provokes among test subjects. Then phase two, it includes hundreds of human test subjects and aims to deliver more information about safety, immunogenicity, immunization, schedule and dose size. Then phase three, it includes thousands or tens of thousands of test subjects, continues to measure the safety and effectiveness of the candidate vaccine. So phase one, phase two and phase three, these are the pre-licensure tests. Then comes regulatory review and approval. So if a vaccine passes through all three phases of clinical development, the vaccine developer submits a BLA, that is Biologics License Application, to the FDA. Then comes manufacturing. So major drug manufacturers provide the infrastructure, personnel and equipment necessary to create mass quantities of vaccine. They also reap the profits of successful or widely distributed drugs. And then quality control. So phase 4 trials, like multiple systems including phase 4 trials, which are the optional studies that can be conducted following the release of a vaccine. The Vaccine Adverse Event Reporting System, that is VAERS, and Vaccine Safety Data Link are designed to monitor the performance, safety and effectiveness of an approved vaccine. Now, who all are involved in vaccine production? First, health professionals. Those with advanced degrees in biology, chemistry, epidemiology, medicine, and a variety of other health fields play a crucial role in identifying and vetting vaccines. Second, manufacturers and private industry. Developing and testing a vaccine are expensive processes and rife with the potential for liability, which means that funding must come from private institutions such as pharmaceutical industries. Then non-governmental organizations, NGOs. These institutions can act as an important conduit between communities and manufacturers with the goal of easing communication in regions where a vaccine is needed. Then academia. The academic community conducts valuable research that has the potential to help other stakeholders understand what can be learned about myriad aspects of vaccination development process. Then government agencies. Like in United States, federal agencies such as FDA must serve as the check and balance for any vaccine that will be made available to the general public. Then individuals and communities. So the general public plays a crucial role in determining the safety and effectiveness of a vaccine. From participating in trials to serving as end users for an approved drug, understanding the real-world implications of a vaccine comes down to this group.
Then challenges. The greatest challenge for protection of the human population against serious infectious disease through vaccination remains access to vaccines and huge associated inequity in access. Access to vaccines is currently limited to varying degree in different regions by the absence of health infrastructure to deliver vaccines. The lack of convenient vaccine provision for family, the lack of financial resources to purchase available vaccines at a national, local or individual level, and marginalization of communities in need. This is perhaps the most pressing issue for public health, with global vaccine coverage having stalled. Other important issues can compromise vaccine availability and access. For example, most vaccines must be refrigerated 2 to 8 degrees Celsius, requiring the infrastructure and capacity for cold storage and a cold chain to the clinic where the vaccine is delivered, which is limited in many low-income countries. Then even route of administration. Route of administration can also limit access. Oral vaccines such as rotavirus, polio or cholera vaccine and nasal vaccines such as live attenuated influenza vaccine can be delivered rapidly on huge scale by less skilled workers. whereas most vaccines are injected. Which requires more training to administer and takes longer. Then another challenge is commercial viability. The second important issue is the lack of vaccine for some diseases for which there is no commercial incentive for development. Typically, these are diseases that have restricted geographical spread, such as Rift Valley fever, Ebola, or plague, or occur in sporadic outbreaks and only affect poor or displaced communities such as Ebola and cholera. Another challenge is immunological challenge. For other pathogens, there is likely to be a commercial market, but there are immunological challenges for the development of new vaccines. For example, highly variable pathogens, including some with a large global distribution, such as HIV, hepatitis C, Hepatitis C virus pose a particular challenge. The genetic diversity of these pathogens, which occur both between and within hosts, make it difficult to identify an antigen that can be used to immunize against infection. In the case of HIV, antibodies can be generated that neutralize the virus, but the rapid mutation of the viral genome means that the virus can evade these responses within the same host. Then another challenge is vaccines generally take many years to reach the market. Vaccine development often takes 10 to 15 years of laboratory research, usually at a company in private industry, but often involves collaboration with researchers at a university. And also the profit margins from developing vaccines are not as interesting as those from developing other drugs. Now kindly remember that vaccines do not save lives. It's the vaccination. Vaccines do not save lives, vaccinations do. So new methods of delivery, shelf life formulas, consideration of benefits of a vaccine campaign beyond preventing disease in an individual, creating robust communications to build vaccine demand, and tapping into new and innovative markets can all build global momentum towards better immunization coverage. So there are several innovations which are done in this field of vaccine development. First is messenger RNA technology. Messenger RNA vaccines contain messenger RNA, which is essentially a genetic blueprint that tells the body how to produce a protein that will trigger the immune system to generate the precise antibodies and immune cells needed to destroy a particular bacteria or virus. Messenger RNA molecules are easier to produce in the laboratory than the proteins or viral fragments used in other types of vaccines, which means that the messenger RNA vaccines can be manufactured more rapidly. So this is an innovation in vaccine development that now the messenger RNA vaccines are being developed. Then vaccine delivery. As I told you earlier that newer methods of delivery are being needed in order to for better immunization coverage. So vaccine delivery, one of the innovation is microarray patches. Microarray patches or MAPs are coin-sized patches covered either with tiny needles coated in dry vaccine that painlessly penetrate the skin or a formula that dissolves when the patch is pressed onto the skin for 2 to 5 minutes. These patches don't require cold temperatures, weigh significantly less than vials requiring needles and syringes, and don't require any mixing and can be given by untrained community health workers in almost any conditions. Plus, there is a needle-free advantage of painless delivery, upping the odds that people will get all of the vaccinations they need. Then now, scientists and researchers, they are building the malaria vaccines as well. Actually, researchers have been trying to develop a malaria vaccine for over 100 years. But high titers, exceptionally high titers of antibodies to protect against any stage of parasite's life cycle is needed, which is hard to achieve. So two vaccines are now showing promise, that is RTSS and R21 matrix M. Both of which target a specific protein on malaria parasite, although both require 4 doses to achieve the immune response needed to fight off an infection. And their vaccines show efficacy of 67 to 75% in adults and up to 80% in children aged 5 to 17 months. And even better, this RTSS R21 MM don't require sub-zero storage temperatures. And this particular vaccine, R21MM in particular, has a long shelf life. It comes in single vial that don't need to be mixed and can withstand temperatures up to 104 degree Fahrenheit for 2 weeks, making it extremely portable in countries where malaria is endemic. And both of these have met the safety standards, and vaccinated people maintain good antibody level for more than 2 years after the primary series. So Ghana and Nigeria, they have both approved the vaccines for use in children aged 5 months to 3 years. And in year 2021, World Health Organization, WHO, recommended RTSS to all children under 2 in sub-Saharan Africa. Then respiratory syncytial virus, RSV, is the most important cause of acute lower respiratory tract infection in young children worldwide. RSV poses a significant threat to very young children and elderly adults in every country in the world. So maternal RSV pre-F vaccine from Pfizer, which was given to pregnant women at 24 to 36 months gestation during phase 3 clinical trials, saw 70 to 80% protection against severe disease for infants up to 6 months after birth. And even two monoclonals, nirsevimab and clesrovimab, in late stage development show high efficacy against all endpoints, and it's anticipated that the new products will be on the market by end of 2023. Then another innovation is TB vaccine. There is currently one TB vaccine on the market, that is BCG. A live attenuated, that is weakened vaccine with so-so efficacy, that is 18% against infection and 75% reduction in deaths, but only through age 15 and limited use as it's not safe for those with HIV, which is a key population of people at a risk of TB, tuberculosis. So a TB vaccine pipeline with several candidates in phase 3 clinical trials does exist, and this process is slow and it's unlikely we'll see a new a TB vaccine brought to market this year, but this offers another opportunity to start building demand. Then another innovation is Shigella vaccine. Shigella is the second leading cause of diarrheal deaths worldwide and the most common bacterial cause of moderate to severe diarrhea in children under 5. In addition to huge number of infections in children, Shigella infects travelers also and is a significant antimicrobial threat all over the world, making it an excellent candidate for vaccine development. So these are a few of the innovations in the process of vaccine development.
In conclusion, the journey of vaccine development in the realm of life sciences encapsulates a narrative of perseverance, innovation, and collective endeavor. The journey of creating vaccine is like a story of never giving up, finding new ways and working together. Scientists face many challenges but keep going with creativity and teamwork. Now with faster and better vaccines, we are entering an exciting new era. Let's appreciate the hard work of scientists everywhere and keep using science to make the world healthier for everyone. Thank you.